They say they tried to save him, ended up killing him. A homeless man that the police picked up, put in the city jail, only to have his head knocked against the wall. It's a police go in saying they're trying to save him. What are the problems that the homeless are facing on a daily basis? And what are the answers? We're going to look at that during this program. Be sure you stay tuned. I'm Larry Rice, and this is Here's Help. Not a very pretty picture of a homeless man dying in a police cell. The Teflon chief says that there's no video that we can show you otherwise. And so we heard he was trying to hang himself. So all the officers went in there and his head gets knocked up against the wall and he's dead. They're still investigating it. But the homeless, they're often just picked up here and there. This man picked up because they said he was trespassing because he was in a vacant building. But where are the people supposed to sleep at night? And that's why we're asking you to just continue to keep the homeless in your prayers, the one that Jesus identified with. Matthew 8:20, when he said, "Foxes have holes, birds have nests, but he, the Son of Man, had nowhere to lay his head." That's why the homeless Jesus statue is in front of the 1411 Locust Building. That's why we continue to fight, whether it's in federal court or wherever we have to, in order to see that people have a place to sleep at night, that they're not picked up for trespassing, thrown in jail, and then die. Well, we'll see what the rest of the story is as more and more continues to come to the light. But again, they have only the word of the police officers like they had in Chicago when a man is shot 16 times. And we wonder what is really happening when the homeless die in jail cells like this. Anyone can end up homeless at any time. Tell us your name.
My name's Nick Boyer.
Where are you from?
Arnold, Missouri.
And you came to New Life Evangelistic Center. Were you one of those that had no place to stay?
Yes, sir. I had been sleeping on the streets, and it was just getting extremely cold.
You were sleeping on the streets. Anybody bother you when you were out there?
People, every time I woke up, somebody was going through my pockets. Wallet stolen, phone stolen, anything that I may have that was potentially decent. Yeah, it got stolen overnight while I was sleeping.
Where were some of the places you were sleeping at?
I'd usually sleep down here at this Christ Cathedral Church by the library, or I'd sleep over by Edwards Jones Dome up under the bridge.
So that's where you'd be sleeping at?
Yes. A couple different times I've gotten trespassing charges from the police for sleeping, usually over by St. Patrick's Center.
You'd say, yeah, St. Patrick's Center, you hear a lot about it, but they don't provide shelter. You sleep around there, so then they'll write you up and give you a trespassing charge?
Yes, I actually currently, I have a court date for it.
Did they threaten to arrest you like they did this man?
Yes.
And put you in jail? When you hear about this man that was arrested for trespassing, put in jail, and then literally dies at the hands of 8 police officers saying they're trying to rescue him because they said he was somehow going to try to choke himself with his sweatpants, which I don't know how he'd do that. But anyway, so, you know, can you identify with that?
Yeah. Yeah, they take whatever story and embellish it to whatever they feel is necessary to.
Yeah, and it's sad that the newspaper goes right along with it, makes it the title, "Man Who Tried to Hang Himself in St. Louis over Holdover Cell Dies After Struggle with Police." Even the articles try to make it, embellish it, to tell you, okay, you read that, so just dismiss it. But this is what people are experiencing on a daily basis. Arrested, threatened to be arrested, and you said they've threatened you with arrest a number of times out there.
Yes. Yes, they even ticketed me for standing on a vent down by the Scott Trade Center trying to warm up when it was about 10 degrees.
Ticketed you?
Yeah, this was about a year ago they did that. They gave me a ticket standing on a vent that blows out warm air. I'd only been there about 2 minutes and cop pulled up and gave me a ticket.
And what'd you do with the ticket?
It's still in court.
So it's written up. So the ongoing harassment. And it's only getting worse. We had to go to federal court, and here we still are, but still hanging over the head. Are they going to give us the permits? Aren't they going to give us the permits? We've hired architects, we hire lawyers, just trying to protect the right for people to have a place to sleep. And that's why it's so critical. You pray for the work of New Life Evangelistic Center at this time, and you support that work. And you support that work with your gifts as we move into the Christmas season, that you let Christ's light and love flow through you. Christ, the hope of Christmas. And we want to let that hope flow into the lives of those that are hurting and homeless. So you decided to come to the New Life Evangelistic Center and get involved in a transitional housing program?
Yes, sir.
How is that working for you?
It's going good. I've been here 3 days. This is my third day now. And each day it's I can tell that there's a little, I'm getting a little more progress. So,
do you feel like you're drawing closer to the Lord?
Yes. Yes, I do. That was one of the main reasons that, I did come here, because I wanted to develop my relationship with Christ fully. I just feel that, you know, even if I am going to be homeless, that that's the number one key to survival and, any type of success, is that you're going to have to humble yourself and just submit to Christ fully.
That's it. Just totally surrender unto Him. For He's the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by Jesus. And we have a Heavenly Father that invites us to come into His presence. And His children are out on the streets. They're hurting. They're homeless, being locked up. And in your case, threatening you with trespassing charges, lock you up. You're sleeping out around a church. You said sleeping around St. Patrick Center and standing on a vent, and they write you a ticket on it. Do you see that this, though, by being at New Life, is going to help break the cycle of homelessness for you?
Yeah. After 90 days, I'm hoping, you know, that I have a job and that I am able to obtain my own place and get my life reestablished again.
That would be an answer to prayer, wouldn't it?
Yes, it would.
Just totally break that cycle of homelessness.
Yes, sir.
And we want to be that answer to prayer that Christ has called each and every one of us to be. Oh, there's so many testimonies I could share with you at this particular time. I think I'd like to share the testimony with you from Scott Egan. Scott's a veteran. He came to the New Life Evangelistic Center sent here by the Veterans Hospital after he was trying to help people after a tornado came through, destroyed his home. He's working with the Red Cross. Hot water was poured all over him. He used to even work with the Salvation Army. Couldn't get in there because their walk-in shelter, 3010 Washington, had closed. So his only option was the New Life Evangelistic Center, where he's here on the staff at the New Life Evangelistic Center. He was recently sharing with his brothers and sisters in Christ what Christ is doing in his life, what Christmas meant to him, and the hope that he now has.
There's a couple of things that I wanted to share with you. It wasn't what I had planned on sharing, but it kind of bubbled up inside me while I was waiting. These things are kind of like bookends on my 34 years of active duty in the Army. My first tour in Vietnam, we happened to be on the border between North Vietnam and Laos in the Annamite Mountains on a pilot who had been shot down. We were on a rescue mission for him over Christmas. It's my first Christmas at war. And we were still eating sea rations back then. And normally what we do, we'd get the boxes that they all came in, and we'd take the accessory packet that had like the hot chocolate and the Kool-Aid and the gum. And I didn't smoke, so I gave my cigarettes away. But I would gather people's coffee and the sugar packets and creamers. And one of the things that I kept, because I thought it was about one of the only edible things, no matter how long they'd been packed, it was not unusual for us to get cases of sea rations in 1969, 1970 that had been packed during the Korean War, 1953 up to 1954. A lot of the stuff had pretty much lost its flavor, or it tasted like tin. But one of the things we'd get would be pound cake, like this little tin, about that tall and about as wide as a normal soup can, that had pound cake in it, and then sliced peaches was really good. So we would save the pound cake and sliced peaches for special occasions. And this first Christmas that we were out, I gave it to the guy who was my spotter and my partner the entire time I served in Special Forces. His name was Robert Redhand. He was a full-blooded Blackfoot Indian. And I had one can of peaches left and one can of pound cake, and I put it in a sock and I gave it to him for Christmas. And little did I know, but he gave me exactly the same thing at the same time. He had saved that can of pound cake and that can of peaches to give me for Christmas. So that was my first Christmas at war. And then in the second Gulf War, we were serving with the Kurds, and the Kurds have, I don't know if you'd want to call it a legend or a story. What a lot of people don't know is that a lot of the Kurds are Christians. Okay, they're either Eastern Orthodox or they're Coptic Christians, which is a branch of Christianity, part of the Eastern Orthodox Church, but that originated in Egypt. And the Kurds have stories in their oral traditions that it was Philip who came to them after he had gone to Ethiopia, and having flown across it in about 30 minutes and knowing that it was one of the easiest routes in the trade route, it's not very much to take a boat to go from Ethiopia over to the area that's now Iraq or in Iran. Okay, you can sail that in a little more than a day if the wind is right. So it's not unusual to think that Philip would have made that journey after he had finished doing his missionary thing in Ethiopia. But the Kurds tell that the long tradition that started with Daniel about them being advisors and wise men to Nebuchadnezzar and then following Babylonian kings and then in the Persian Empire, ultimately, that the wise men who came to Jerusalem were actually Jews in that same tradition of being very learned and very knowledgeable advisors to the rulers of Persia, you know, Babylon first and then Persia when Persia pretty much took over that part of Asia Minor from Babylon. And they tell the story that they recognized that sign in the heavens because that had been foretold in Daniel. So they had that tradition for always passing those traditions on to watch for that star that would rise, that would signify that the king had been born, the Messiah had been born to Israel, and that that's why they came. And when I heard that, it seemed that there was a kind of a rightness and a symmetry to it. So those are kind of like the bookends to my military career that took place over a Christmas. And I've got something really short I wanted to add to that. Psalm 27:14 is, I gave this to Chris fairly soon after I got here when we were really busy and kind of having a bad day, but it says, wait on the Lord. Be strong and let your heart take courage. Wait on the Lord. Psalm 27, verse 14. Mm-hmm. And Advent is translated not literally. Literally means coming out of or coming from in Latin. But it's usually translated as arrival. You know, we're used to waiting for things to arrive. We wait for planes to arrive. We wait for the mail to arrive every day. You know, 2,000 years ago, the Jewish people were waiting for the Messiah. Some of them realized that he had come in the person of Jesus, who fulfilled every prophecy of the Messiah that had been foretold in the Old Testament and by the prophets. We often don't take waiting very well, you know. Everything, we're a fast food nation. We want everything right now. We don't want to wait for anything. You know, the instant gratification is the norm in our world. You know, Twitter and Instagram are the primary ways that we stay connected with people. But what kind of connection is that? You know, I saw my own sons, the younger two, that didn't really affect the older two as much, but they would sit across the dining room table and instant message each other on their phones. And it's like, You were sitting across the table from each other. Put down your phones and talk to each other. One of the things that when I grew up, and then I tried to do the same thing for my own kids and my friends who would come over, was that time at dinner, it was nothing for us to spend 3 or 4 hours at the dinner table, because dinner was as much about conversation and community and strengthening those bonds that made us a family as it was about actually putting food in so that we'd have enough energy to get through the next day. And God's redemption that we wait to work itself out in our own lives and in our world is something that was planned and orchestrated over thousands and tens of thousands of years. You know, we want it to be accomplished in our lives right now. In 2 minutes, in the time it takes to heat up a mug of coffee in a microwave. God doesn't work like that. So I want you to spend some time between now and Christmas asking what you're waiting for. Is it for your family to finally start getting along, or you and your spouse to finally be reconciled, or you and your kids to be reconciled? Are you waiting for the season of homelessness or of unemployment to end in your life? Are you waiting for some big move of God? Something flashy, some miracle that's going to light up your whole life? A lot of times we find what we're waiting for. We might be looking for that big, bright miracle that's going to light up our whole life and miss the miracles that happen in our relationships with our brothers and sisters here every day. Over and over again throughout the day, I'm touched by all the small miracles that impact on me. Most of us are somewhere in there. But as you wait for God to work in your life, don't wait in vain. Look around you. Look at the good in other people. I know my mom was really big on that. You know, look for the good in other people. And let us wait in faith that what God has promised will come. It might not be in our time, but it certainly will be in God's time. And God's perfect plan for our life will work itself out if we just give it a chance. Thanks.
Thank you, Scott, for sharing that with us. Yes, God's perfect plan will work out for us if we just surrender to Him. But people have to have some place where they can lay their head as they grow in their faith. Satan will just try to keep push, and just leave them out on the street to be destroyed or picked up for trespassing because they're having to sleep in a vacant house, put in a city jail. Conveniently, the police department doesn't have any video of what happened. They said the man was at city jail trying to hang himself, and instead all the police went in there to save him and ends up getting killed, ends up dying. That's what we know is a fact. They're still exploring the rest of it there, but locking up people that are homeless, that are living in vacant houses. Tell us your name.
Josh Brown.
Josh, did that almost happen to you?
Yes, in South City a couple of times, just in the past 2 months. I noticed there was a house that was burnt down, so I didn't figure anybody care if I went and slept on it because it was raining and cold that night.
Yeah.
And evidently a police officer seen me go in there, and he came in about maybe 20 minutes later, put me in handcuffs in the back of his car, said he wanted to arrest me, but he didn't want to do all the paperwork and just got another call. So I was on my way to jail just because I didn't have nowhere. I've been run off. I'd go to like McDonald's, spend the last money I had just to have somewhere warm to go. And I work at minimum wage. I can get a hotel maybe 2 days a week, 3 days a week tops. I just can't get anything to get me that head start I need to be able to start paying my bills. And so I went from sleeping out on benches when it's not raining to a couple vacant houses. And If a cop comes, you're going to jail. I've been arrested for panhandling about 5 times just to get bus fare, legitimately bus fare, to go to work because I spent all my money on either a hotel room or just trying to get in and out of the cold, spend like $6 on a meal at McDonald's just to sit there. And then when you're done, you can't sit there any longer. They make you leave usually just to get out of the cold at 6-7 o'clock in the morning.
This man that they killed in the city jail, do you think they're just going to kind of shove it under, try to make the man look like it was all his fault and, you know, and his past and buy the police story?
Judging from the police has picked me up, we're a burden to them. They look down on us. We can walk down the road and just say hi to people. They don't even communicate back to us like we're nothing. I mean, really, cops treat us just like we're just a problem or that we're just nothing to them whatsoever. We're expendable. Our lives are expendable.
These are the people that Jesus identified with. These are the people you sing songs about at Christmas time. Away in the manger, a baby laying in a manger because his family's homeless, there's no room for him in the inn. Here he is laying in a manger. You sing about it. You talk about it. The ones Jesus identified with. Matthew 8, verse 20, foxes have holes, birds have nests. He, the Son of Man, had nowhere to lay his head. The ones that Jesus said someday on Judgment Day, we're going to be asked. When I was hungry, did you feed me? Naked, did you clothe me? Sick or in prison, visit me? A stranger, homeless, did you welcome me? As oft you've done to the least these? He said, even so, you've done it unto me. So what's going to be your response? Lord, when did we ever see you that way? Well, read Matthew chapter 25, last part of it. See how you're going to respond. These programs, we come and we call them Here's Help to help you to rise above all the excuses, to help you to have an opportunity to partner with the last major walk-in shelter training center in Mid-America that homeless people walk in, get involved in, plug into, and get the help that they need at the New Life Evangelistic Center. You can find out more about it. Just take a few minutes. Go to www.newlifeevangelisticcenter.org. This is what we hear on a daily basis. Was it always this way for you?
No. I got evicted on September 7th. I'm a veteran myself. I was in the Army Infantry, Big Red 1. I've worked my entire life. I move here. I lose a job. Fell 1 month behind, and I get evicted. He collects my rent and tells me not to go to the court date, that we're good, we're squared up. And on September 7th of 2015, sheriff's knocking on my door. They kept every last possession I had except for what I could carry, and I was out on the street. I'm from Lima, Ohio. I have nobody here.
Out on the street.
Yeah.
So then you try to sleep in a vacant building, and you said they put you in handcuffs, put you in the police car. A policeman says, well, I don't really want to do that paperwork, and gets another call. So what do you do after that?
He goes and drops me off at the South City Schnucks and tells me I need to get on a bus and just get out of here. He don't care what I do. Just don't come in that neighborhood and sleep in the vacant buildings down there.
So
he didn't give me no referral list or anything like that. I mean, didn't point me in a direction of anywhere to go for shelter. He just told me to get out of that area.
How did you find the New Life Evangelistic Center?
I made my way downtown and started asking around, and luckily, thank God, I found this place because now I have somewhere to go rest my head, and it's a huge relief. Like a huge burden has been lifted off my shoulders. I can't even explain it.
This is another veteran. Is this how we treat our veterans? I mean, they do so much slick PR stuff out here and sound like they're really taking care of the veterans. At 8 to 5, maybe they got programs, but where do they sleep all night long? And then you should see the viciousness that and the stuff that Eddie Roth, who's head of human services, told the local NPR station about our training programs here by just giving people opportunities like this. They don't like it at all, so they can't stop it. Why would they want to? I mean, we're taking lives that are out here that are harassed day after day. That when they are picked up or they get a ticket for standing on a heating grate or are locked up. I mean, this is the real world that you don't read about. What you do read about when one's finally killed in the city jail, they gloss over it. Here's the news items. Man who tried to hang himself. That's the official statement from our Teflon police chief. I call him Teflon because he never lets anything stick to him because it's always right off the back. Homeless man locked up, put in jail for trespassing, and then he's killed while they say they're trying to save him. Something's wrong in this whole thing, and it's just glossed over, and it becomes a way of life in this community. And this is a community that you want to live in, and this community people are proud of. I mean, where's the gospel voice? It could happen to anybody. You said you didn't, you know, last year Christmas wasn't like this for you.
Not at all. I spent it with my kids, my family. They moved in with my child's mother's parents. Mm-hmm. I just can't do that. So I'm just living, this time last year, I could never imagine this.
What would you have done if New Life Evangelistic Center hadn't been open to you?
I wouldn't even want to think about it. I suffer from depression just from this issue anyway. I mean, if anything, this is just helping me a lot. So,
did you feel yourself going down? Down, down?
Yeah, I was definitely spiraling down mentally. This life just wears on you mentally. It drives you crazy. It chips away. It tries to eat your soul up, I think, because it's life. Everything you see on the streets, the way you're treated, just walking past businesses, the way you're shooed away, just like you're nothing. Like you're not human. Like you don't have a face.
These are the ones that Jesus is going to ask you about someday. When I was a stranger, did you welcome me? He gives us an opportunity to make a big difference for good. But are we going to let our light so shine before men and women they may see our good works and glorify our fathers in heaven? Or we're just going to give them our excuses, saying why we couldn't, why we wouldn't? Are we going to continue to lock the church doors to those that are hurting and those that are homeless? Come up with the fancy stuff, but nothing as far as the real practical stuff that people need. They don't need more and more of your stuff dumped on in a park. They need you to open your church doors. They need you to give them a place to sleep. They need food to eat. Even the bridge that they used to go through during the daytime, they had to leave Centenary Church, and then they're going to go over to the Abram Building that rightfully belongs to the homeless, the stole by the city, and they call it City Hall West, where the homeless should be there all the time, sheltered, everything else. So letting them come in, but they're not doing showers there anymore. They're not doing meals there anymore. They're not going to let them just sit there during the day anymore. So where are they supposed to go all day long? And when you go out during the day, there's a lot of harassment out there in there.
Yeah, you're just forced to just keep walking, basically. And if you're not walking, you stand too long, you better watch over your shoulders for someone to call the cops or...
So you don't see the police as friendly people to help you?
No. I mean, I've called the cops on getting something stolen from me since I became homeless and got threatened to be put in jail for vagrancy because I had an Ohio ID and couldn't tell them where I was staying in St. Louis. That was another incident.
So you had something stolen from you?
And I called the police.
You called the police, and what happened? They arrived?
Yeah, they took a report and said there's nothing much they can do because it happens all the time. Then he started questioning me about where I have to stay, and he asked me if I was a vagrant, and I told him, I was like, right now, yeah, I can't find anything. He's like, you know you can be arrested for that, right? And gave me a whole lecture about how it's against the law to not have a place to go.
It's against the law not to have a place to go?
Yeah, I mean, yes, vagrancy is against the law. It's a crime.
Well, the United States Justice Department says that these police are breaking the law because they say for the police to continue to keep telling people they got to move on when they have no other place to go is a violation of the Eighth Amendment of the United States Constitution, cruel and unusual punishment. But no, they can freely break the law because they got the guns, they got the power, they got the badges. And they got the Teflon chief that can have a press conference that the media just writes anything and everything he says. That here, we are going to save this homeless guy's life. We locked him up because he was homeless. And so we're holding him. And we thought he was going to commit suicide. So we sent six or eight police officers in there, and his head crashes against it, and he dies. And the media just prints it all up, it seems like, doesn't it?
Yeah, it definitely seems like that. And then a month or two from now, you won't even hear about this. You won't. His death will be in vain from what I've seen.
But God sees all. Years off. That's why we try to provide the direct help at the New Life Evangelistic Center. And that's why your gifts and prayers are so absolutely essential at this particular time. That's why at New Life Evangelistic Center, we want to offer people alternatives to being locked up, sleeping in vacant buildings, on park benches, help them to find a job, help them to start a whole new beginning. It's a holistic program. And so here you've heard on this station the rest of the story that you don't hear often from the other media. And it's your gifts that make that big difference. You can share your tax-deductible gift now with the New Life Evangelistic Center, P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri. That's 63166. Just let Christ's light and love flow through you. And as you do, watch Him do exceedingly beyond what you can even ask or think. Yes, God loves you, and He loves the homeless. Please let His love flow through you.